So we are here with Kane Roberts. How you doing, Kane?
Hey, doing good, man.
Good, good, good. So, boy, you know, there's so much to talk about with you. You've done stuff with Bob Ezrin. You've done stuff writing on a Kiss album. You've played with Alice Cooper. But let's start off real quick with your last album, Unsung Radio. You know, nice hard rocking thing that came out about 2 years ago. How can fans get that?
Well, they can either get it on my website. I think some people have it on eBay, and I know that there was a record company in Germany that put it out initially. It was a two album set, but I would suggest, you know, going to some other outlets. I think it'll be a little less expensive. You know, I know my website. I try to keep the cost down and stuff. That was just an idea I had because I was talking to somebody about, you know, those experiences that we as musicians have of playing those kind of rock and roll bomb shelters, you know, where you drive by, it's a saloon, there's like no window, there might be a Budweiser, you know, flickering light, you know, somewhere in the small slot next to the door, whatever. We were talking about that, and I started thinking how very few people will sort of uncover that part of their musical development, you know, leading up to. For me, it was a huge experience for me to write a song, and maybe I would record it, or maybe I would just play it live and then go into the studio. I mean, I was doing that thing where, you know, I was sort of stealing my way into studios at 3 in the morning and you know, buying the engineer a sandwich or something and trying to record songs. And you know, I started listening to some of that stuff, and some of it, you know, some of it was good. I know that there were a few songs. I actually was hooked up with Pat Travers.
Oh, nice.
When I was just getting started, Doug Thaler, who went on to manage Motley Crue, for some reason ended up was at a club that I was playing at. And then we became friends, and then they flew me down to, he and Doc McGee flew me down to Florida, and, you know, I met Pat, who's a great guy, and we started writing and doing stuff, and it ended up being, I can't remember which album it was, but he ended up shooting videos for each of the songs and everything. So that, you know, that was kind of my first taste of you know, rubbing shoulders with guys that I thought were, you know, really great musicians.
Right.
So it, you know, in that space of time, I was recording stuff. A lot of it's 20, 24 track or 48 track. And I decided to just give people an insight into that and put some of the stuff on there. Obviously, some of it's, developing.
Mm-hmm.
Some of it is, taken from the Phoenix Down album, which I thought was some great stuff there that I wanted to get re-released. And then there's one track on there that I wrote with, I worked on with Kip Winger and Michael Wagner and stuff like that, that's a little bit more recent. So I just think it's been a long time since I had anything out, and I just wanted to get something out there. So
yeah, and you know, let's mention the website. It's kaneroberts.com, and if people go there, they can actually get a signed version of the album.
Yeah, no, the guys that I do that with, I tell them that, I want to include, you know, as much stuff with the CDs as I can. Sometimes we just throw in extra photos, autographed photos and stuff like that. I mean, you know, I run into a lot of musicians in different scenarios. You know, I've been doing that rock and roll fantasy camp,
yep,
or I might be at some autograph signing event. And, you know, there was one that I was at, and this kid comes up to me with he's got his guitar, and he said, will you sign this? And I said, sure, why not? And then I found out there's a lot of guys that won't sign guitars and things like that. And my attitude's always been, you know, even if somebody wants to sell it on eBay, it's like, yeah, go make some money. You know what I mean? I don't know, but huh. I think, you know, one of the things that Alice and I talked about a lot was, for example, if you write a song and you record it, and you listen to it yourself,
Right.
If you, it sounds a certain way. If you sit in front of one person and play it, it feels and sounds completely different, because the whole event, the whole moment is so influenced by other, you know, the other people that are there. So, you know, Alice is one of those guys. I was one of those guys. One of the reasons why we got along is we were definitely simpatico on a lot of thought processes and how the music goes and how we feel and everything. And one of them is that we felt is that the audience is such an integral part of any event, you know, music event that takes place, like, yeah, you know, when, any concert that we do. So I'm full on into, you know, treating them as, you know, another member in the band and just doing whatever I can to, you know, to just, if there's something that they want, if I can get it together, I'll definitely do it.
Yeah, and the other thing that I noticed when you go to your website, there's a link there that says work with Kane. Are you still doing that? Are you still giving?
You know what? I did stop. I had something like 5 or 6. I should take that down. I had like 5 or 6 students at a time, and right, you know, I couldn't handle more than that. And then it got so I could only handle like 2, and then finally I just had to, you know, stop doing it. So that was just me like giving people insights on how to write music and you know, some stuff on guitar and all things like that. Oh, doing the Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp thing was like a great opportunity for me to sort of share some of the knowledge, you know, that, right, that I got from working with guys like, you know, Paul Stanley and Desmond and Alice and, you know, whoever I was lucky enough to
work
with. Shoulders with. Yeah, yeah.
Yes. By the way, you mentioned Kip Winger just before. Have you heard Winger's new album, Better Days Coming?
Yeah, it's really good. I mean, one of the things about him is, you know, whatever he does, whatever he puts out, it's always... That's such a well-performed, mm-hmm, recorded, whatever it is, project. And yeah, this is a perfect example about it. He really gives a shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's one of the things that you all, you know, win, lose, or draw, that you'll always feel. I just heard it, and you know, I really, I loved it. So, yeah
no,
that's a definite thing that people should check out. Yeah,
because I agree. I interviewed Kip last week, and of course he was mentioning you, and... I had been sent the album, and you know, listen, I sort of gave up on Winger after the 90s, and then I heard this album, and it's bloody brilliant. I mean, it's fantastic. But,
well, yeah, that's the thing. It's there's going to be people who are going to, you know, kind of do the status quo, mm-hmm, or what people expect of them. You know, Kip, like, he definitely sweats blood on everything he does.
Absolutely.
And I, you know, you really get the feeling on this, and just, you know, the guitar playing, the singing, the recording, everything is just way off. He totally sings his ass off. So,
yeah. And let me lead this into the Alice Cooper discussion. Let me just start at the end real quick. When Kip and you left, which was sort of at the same time, was there,
yeah,
any thought of you two making a band together, or you joining Winger, or any kind of collaboration?
No, we were thought that, you know, maybe some point we'll write together or do something together, but the trajectory was definitely in different directions.
Okay.
Just sort of, you know, split off, yeah.
Okay, so let's go back to the beginning then with Alice Cooper, and then after this we'll talk about your songwriting with Desmond and working with Bob and all
cool.
that.
Yeah.
Listen, when you joined Alice, his career was essentially over. I mean, he had, you know, gotten to himself in a place where he almost, to me, looked like he was going to die. He was thin. He was unhealthy. How did he recruit you? Where did you come from? How do you all of a sudden get together with a Alice Cooper on a comeback trail?
Well, you know, I remember... I was in New York,
right?
And I had my band. We were opening for bands like Molly Hatchet and Joan Jett and bands like that.
Right.
And you know, those were incredible experiences for
absolutely.
Us. Obviously, I mean, you know, we did a series of something like 5. We played one show with Molly Hatchet, and they liked us. So we they said, you know, we want you to do the next 4 or 5 shows with us. So we said okay. And the funny thing is, you know, my band was so typical. I mean, the drummer had an ancient milk truck, and that was our equipment truck. And you know what I mean? So when Molly Hatchet saw that, they said, you know what, just throw your stuff in with ours. And that's how great, you know, the community was. We felt really good because, you know, our transportation, we were sleeping on top of, you know, bass cabinets and, you know, and stuff like that. So it was pretty rugged, but you know, we ended up touring with them. Joan Jett, I remember when we opened for her, she came down and listened to our set. She was right off to the side of the stage, and you know, moments like that are you know, obviously memorable. And then we got a chance to open for Alice Cooper, and I you know, I had never met him, and you know, I didn't meet him that night. Right. But it was that tour, Special Forces tour, where, you know, he looked a little bit corpse-like, you know.
Yeah.
He
didn't look healthy. Let's just put it
that
way.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, always insanely great, but you know, it was just one of those things. So yeah.
I didn't think about it.
And then I was playing in clubs, you know, doing that circuit around, you know, the East Coast, you know, Connecticut and everything. And the way I've told people this before, but the way I made money was, I would play the gig and maybe get $20, and then I would go deal cards at this fully illegal blackjack game that was run by these guys. You know, when I would walk in the door, the first thing they would do, because what they would do is they move it from hotel to hotel, and we would be in like the conference room or the penthouse or whatever, and there'd be all these tables set up, and they'd show me where all the guns were. You know, that was the first thing they'd do. And then I'd sit down and I'd deal cards from like, you know, 1 a.m. till 8 a.m. And that's sort of how I survived. But, you know, at one point, I guess Alice had come up and listened to the band and then left. And, you know, I'm not sure. I think only the club owner knew he was there. And, you know, and then he ended up, I got a phone call from Shep Gordon, the management, and he said, you know, you want to come down and meet with me and Alice and Bob Ezrin? And I said, yeah, you know. And, you know, one thing that is definitely significant about that is, you know, when I walked in the door, I definitely realized I was amongst people who had created, you know, a big part of culture. They'd influenced culture that much and innovated and, you know, changed the world in a lot of ways. And yet, at the same time, with all the respect that I had, I really felt like, you know, I fit in. I never felt completely in awe of people to the point where I was disconnected, you know what I mean? I didn't take myself out of the moment. And I think it's a really important thing to do. If for some reason that you get caught in the jet stream, you got to just step into it and just say, you know what, I belong here. And that's kind of always been my attitude. And then, you know, Alice and I really hit it off incredibly well. He's one of the funniest guys I've ever met. I mean, we both, you know, to this day, we'll tell each other, like, first day that we met, we both never laughed so hard. So, you know, once the creative hookup was made, you know,
what was the hookup though? Was it a guitarist audition, or was it a writing session, or was it a, hey, let's check this guy out and just see if he can hang with us, and then we'll go from there?
The first thing I did is they sat me in an office in front of Bob Ezrin.
That's not intimidating.
No, and Ezrin said, look, you know, he gave me all the compliments, you know, talented writer, this and that. He said, I think if you become part of a writing team, I think your potential will be realized, you know, to a greater degree. And I, you know, I had no problem with that. And he said, you know, Alice worked with a bunch of guys on trying to get some of this stuff together. One of the things that we did hear about you is that, you know, you don't abuse drugs or drink or any of that stuff. And he said, those are, you know, that's a plus, you know, for us, but we need to make sure that, you know, you guys work, you know, can work together creatively. And he said, it'll be the three of us, you know. And then I went in and I, you know, Alice was sitting there with, you know, in this huge office with his management and, you know, accountants and all these people. I just sat down and, you know, we were good to go. The first project was supposed to be a heavy metal movie done sort of in the same style as the Sergeant Pepper album with Peter Frampton and all those guys, it was going to be sort of this. It's going to have Twisted Sister and Def Leppard and all this stuff. So that was our first project that we wrote for, and then
What year was this?
Eighty something. I don't know. You know,
Constrictor came out in 86. So are we looking at 85? Because I mean, Alice after
84 or 85, okay. Somewhere in there. Okay. Yeah. And you know, keep in mind, after that meeting, we went and we wrote a little bit in upstate New York. We hung out there for some reason, and then suddenly, like, I'm on a plane to L.A., and then I walk into Shep's house. And, you know, remember, I was playing strip clubs on rock night and dealing cards. That was what I was doing. And somewhere I'm in this, like, beautiful mansion in Beverly Hills, and these naked girls come running out and jump into a pool. You know what I mean? And I'm just sitting there going, like, wow, what a complete sort of dimensional shift. And then the next day, they flew me to Maui, which is where Alice and I started, you know, writing for the Constrictor album.
Yeah.
So we were there for like 2 or 3 months, you know, right on the ocean. You know, it was just sort of a quantum shift in terms of, like, you know, the whole, my personal time space continuum. Everything got, like, you know, radically changed suddenly. So, you know, it was a lot to take in, but, you know, again, I just rolled with it. And then, you know, the other thing we discussed is, yeah, if Alice is going to make a comeback, you know, what should it be?
Right. That was my next question. Did they set down some parameters? It has to be hard rock. Or, listen, 86, you're talking Motley Crue was popular. Def Leppard had Pyromania. And then they had that big space where they didn't do anything. Did they say, okay, we have to make a Def Leppard song? Or,
well, you know what happened was they gave us complete freedom in terms of...
Right.
You know, of course, I sat down and we had discussions and everything, but what I, you know, my first, you know, serious discussion with Alice was, rather than Alice having survived rehab, mm-hmm. I said, I think it was important that he come back almost a nuclear version of what he was in the past. And the key was going to be able to preserve enough of the mystique and music mm-hmm. integrity of, you know, his initial... you know, from those early albums, and then just sort of, you know, upgrade or just intensify the amount of energy and you know, coming off the stage or off the albums or whatever. So, you know, I you know, if I was going to be 100% honest, I think the recording situation of Constrictor was good, but I think, you know, Raise Your Fist and Yell was when we really sort of hit our mark in terms of, like, sort of a heavy, you know, dark, you know, extreme energy Alice yeah. Cooper, you know what I mean? So, yeah. So, I mean, I think we, you know, if people buy that DVD of The Nightmare Returns, you know, they'll see that, you know, we started off in the classic Alice way, and when Alice kicks that cage down and enters the stage, it just explodes into this, you know, new Alice Cooper that was going to, you know, compete with whoever else was out there.
Yeah, actually, I was going to ask you about that show. That was that show in Detroit, Halloween, and was it MTV that was broadcasting, or was
yeah, it was live on MTV, yeah.
And that was essentially his first show in a few years. Was there any special tension or nervousness, or were you like, uh-oh, what have we gotten ourselves
into? Well, there was with the band.
Right.
I mean, every band member was taken from, you know, relative obscurity into, you know, suddenly this huge stage. And you know, it was essentially our first show. All we'd done is rehearsed over at, you know, Fox Studios in Hollywood. And, you know, suddenly there we were. And so, you know, the band was on such an intense dose of adrenaline. And, you know, the thing that was so evident was, as soon as Alice hit the stage, we just, like, got caught up in his flow, because he just, you know, I was watching and learning while it was happening. Of course, I was inside the moment, but every once in a while I'd realize, you know, he was communicating with the last seat in the nosebleed, you know, section, you know what I mean? So, yeah. We realized that he was such a master of how to deal with an audience and get a show done, that that sort of nervous thing kind of went away immediately, you know. So, and then we were off and running. Then it was just, you know, I'm one of those guys, I could tour forever. It's like the best, you know, life for a male, I think, possible. So, yeah,
I can think. Now, you know, yeah. I've heard from other guitarists that have been in Alice Cooper's band that it is the most exhausting show to play in, because there really is no break for the guitarist. There's always sort of a background music going during, you know, the hangings or the electrocution. There's always something going. You don't really get a break. Is that the case? I mean, is it a really tough gig?
You know, I didn't see it that way. I mean, I just thought of it as insane amount of fun. I just had a great time the whole time. You know, the only thing I noticed about it was there were times during each tour where things did get a little dark. I mean, Alice would sort of enter like a different zone, and the whole sort of stage would be colored a certain way. And not as if anybody was going to get, you know, seriously hurt or whatever, but you just had to, you know, I was talking to John Five about it. He said, you know, it was the kind of the same thing. You know, he came from K.D. Lang to Marilyn Manson, and he said, you know, it's just a different, you know, things start flying around, and you know, the whatever the energy transfer between the audience and the band, it goes into an area that other bands don't necessarily, you know, experience it. And you know, I called it, you know, just essentially on stage we had a culture of violence that we were, you know, that we were like, you know, presenting to the world, you know, and the music was just sort of flowing around through this like insane cauldron of like some dark energy or heaviness sometimes. So, but I never, you know, I never found it exhausting. So.
Never found it exhausting. Let me ask you about your look. I mean, back in the 80s, every sort of guitarist was, you know, 110 pounds wet and you know, they all looked like they could use lunch. Was it a conscious decision to bulk up, or was that something that Alice Cooper's guys came to and said, "We need to get you big"? I mean,
no, I was already into that to a certain degree, and okay. It was one of the reasons why I think they gravitated towards me a little bit, because they're all guys that, you know, Alice might have been the first guy to put on a dress, or at least to the extent that he did, you know, and perform, like, you know, and that look and that sort of radical stuff that he was doing. And I think they liked the fact that I was a little bit against the grain, right, you know, in that regard. And then, you know, one of the things that happened was I ended up, you know, when I came to California, I'm like in Los Angeles, I'm in Venice Beach training with like total freaks, you know what I mean? So I ended up getting really big, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, especially, you know, training with, you know, some of those women and those guys that were just, you know, full on professionals, you know what I mean? So,
yeah. Do you think that look harmed you as a guitarist, in the sense that, do you think people might have said, "Oh, he's not a real guitarist. He's just some big muscle guy"? Did you ever get that?
You know, I think I knew that it wasn't gonna, the two things wouldn't add up.
Right.
I just knew. I didn't care.
Okay.
I knew that, you know what I mean? Otherwise, I wouldn't have done it, or I would have stopped, or I would have tried to, you know, maybe I should trim down for the, you know. I just, if my life, you know, if I felt like I was kind of done with doing that, which it did happen at some point. Mm-hmm. After the Alice, the second tour, I kind of got, you know, over it, and I just sort of slowed down on all of that stuff. You know, it just started like around the Saints and Sinners album and stuff like that. But
91.
But the thing is that, but yeah, I think I didn't care. I knew that was happening. I mean, and I know, like, even standing outside, if I saw a guy that was that big, I mean, I wasn't just a little big. It was one point, you know, I was like 230 pounds, you know what I mean? So I don't think, I don't know what I would do with how I would assimilate that either. But I just felt like, you know, if the camera passed over me once, people would remember me. And that ended up being true.
That ended up being true. In an interview last year, you talked about how you got so big. Can we talk about that today, or should
sure.
we? Oh, well, okay. You mentioned that you had used steroids.
Yeah.
How did that decision come about? I mean, were you just sitting at the beach, at Venice Beach one day and said, "Hey, I'm going to take steroids"? Like, how do you get into that? I mean, how did that
start?
Well,
you know, when you walk into Gold's in Venice, they hand you a syringe. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. No, the thing is that it's like anything. In other words, my peers suddenly became people that were doing that a lot. And, okay. You know, I was about 175, mm-hmm. I was trying to get 180 pounds. And then, you know, somebody said, you know, you got to think of it like too, is like, you know, when you're a kid in high school, somebody might walk up to you with, you know, some drug and say, hey, you want to try this? It's that sort of a thing. Right. So it was the same deal. And, you know, I just started doing it. And then, you know, one of the things I did immediately was I started doing it under a doctor's supervision. Right. And then, you know, I just think there's a lot of stigma attached to that. If you're doing it with a doctor, or whatever, you know, that's the only way to ever do it. Whether or not there's some sort of, you know, negative, there's a negative to, you know, most of the stuff that we do, I'm not recommending it for anybody,
right.
But my point is that, you know, there's a lot of kind of a stigma attached to the whole thing. And if you do it in moderation and you keep your head together about it, you know, I know that there were guys and girls doing, you know, gallons compared to what I was doing.
Right.
And, you know, I obviously couldn't if I'm on tour. I one of the things I was thinking about the other day is like, you know, we would travel maybe 48 or 72 hours on a bus trip. And the rest of the band would grab a candy bar and go to, you know, their rooms. And Alice, you know, would go to the golf course, and I'd look up, you know, a gym at whatever city we're in, you know, no matter what country it was, and go work out. So, you know, it was a lot of sort of devotion to that really got me a lot of the size. But yeah, I mean, I did do it. I mean, whether or not I regret doing it.
I didn't ask that, but do you?
No, I'm just thinking about it, you know, just because I know people might be wondering. I really don't, because I think, you know, I kept my wits about me, and sure. I didn't go into like the abuse territory of it. So,
well, I'll ask you these two questions then. You know, we're now 2014. Do you think it had any negative impact on your body? I mean, are you feeling a little sore than you think you should? Is there something going on with your spleen, your kidney? Like, is there any?
Nah, there's none of that stuff.
Okay.
And the other thing too is that you know, the one thing I wanted to tell everybody is like, I was 175, 178, 179, and suddenly, you know, within whatever period of time, I'm 210.
Right.
You know, that's a lot of steak. You know what I mean?
With no body fat either.
Yeah, so I mean, at one point, you know, like I was pushing 230. So yeah, I mean, it's it makes a huge difference, and it has a tremendous effect on, you know, your physique, whether your body and your health and stuff, whether or not I got any negatives from it, none of them have manifested so far, but... Right. I don't mind being kind of like a guinea pig or test tube, you know, for
that stuff.
What's going to happen. So, yeah.
And then the last question I'll ask you about that, and then we'll move on to, you know, more enjoyable topics, is, was the Alice Cooper camp aware of the use, or was it just the great unspoken, or were they like, oh, yeah, man, let's go get bigger. You look great on stage.
No, they never, see, that's the thing about those guys. A lot of it has to do with Shep and the way Alice is. They're sort of energy people. In other words, I know it sounds a little bit, you know, kind of like hippie stuff, but, you know, if energy is positive, if the flow is moving forward, you know, all that sort of a thing, they just roll with it. So, you know, Shep became kind of a mentor for me, you know, because he's such a brilliant guy, and, you know, the kind of businessman that he is, and he's also, you know, he can hang with the most creative people, and he just knows, you know, what to say and how to keep things, you know, moving forward.
Right.
So he's the ultimate enabler in terms of, because he's responsible for so much that happened, you know, with a lot of bands' careers and you know, obviously Alice and mine. And Alice is the same way. I mean, he never even brought it up.
Okay, so
you know what I mean? It was never even like, hey, you're big. You never did that.
Okay,
so, to me, he might have mentioned it in an interview, but I, you know, I don't know.
Okay, so it sort of was the great unspoken. You just were the guitarist, and he left you alone, kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
All right, so Constrictor comes out and does a modicum of success. Raise Your Fist and Yell comes out, puts Alice on the map. Now, you know, Alice is back, and we got that show. but we're not selling in the Def Leppard Hysteria numbers. We're not doing Bon Jovi Slippery When Wet numbers. Do they at that time say, okay, we need to go to Plan B? Or is it, hey, listen, we've done the best two albums we could. Thank you very much. Or did you and Kip just decide, all right, it's enough, we're leaving? What happens there after?
Well, I think Kip left after the Nightmare Returns tour.
Right.
The band was just, you know, at the end of the, you know, before, you know, after that, the band was just so, we just hit the ground running. We were just, we've been playing, you know, so many shows. I mean, there's, you know, the really, really huge bands will come to a town and do like one show in a week.
Right.
Or maybe two. And then they go to the next town. Well, you know, we were working pretty hard. You know, there'd be three, maybe four shows in one week. You know, mm-hmm. we're traveling all over the world. So the band's ability to play and communicate was just, you know, it was just at a very intense level. So Alice and I had been writing, had been writing, you know, the whole time. I know we enlisted Kip to write the harpsichord part mm-hmm. for Gale. That's one song that you know goes into Roses on White Lace.
On White Lace, yeah.
Yeah, we did this sort of, you know, serial killer type, you know, dark trilogy for that. And, you know, we when we finished Raise Your Fist, I mean, we just knew, you know, we'd written something that was, you know, very heavy.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
And cool. it wasn't, you know, it wasn't made for like, you know, top 40, top 20, you know, radio, whatever. But we just felt like, you know, that was the flow at the time. We wanted to get, you know, heavy and just, you know, move in that direction. We did write, you know, we did look at his old stuff. In other words, his older stuff, like when you look at, you know, I Want to Be Elected, you know, that song.
Elected.
We thought Freedom could be, you know, anthemic in kind of the same way. So we were always paying attention okay. to, you know, his classic albums while we were writing. And then at the end of Raise Your Fist and Yell, I ended up, you know, I suddenly had a record deal on Geffen. And, you know, we kind of felt like, you know, it was almost like, you know, you talk about things were unspoken. Suddenly that was like this unspoken separation. We just stopped. And it wasn't as if we were never going to play again. We almost did back in 94. I almost joined the band again. But
that would have been fun.
Yeah, but we ended up, I had other commitments and I was doing some other stuff, so I was kind of unable to do it. But, you know, we still like, we're going to try to write again for, you know, this year and stuff like that. So the separation was very amicable, but yeah, and I, you know, we even wrote something for the Trash album, but it just never got used, me, Alice, and Desmond. So, so yeah, no. So the separation was kind of a natural stream of things. And I know they wanted to, you know, once you hired Desmond Child, you're changing the entire landscape of what, you know, what had happened previously.
Well,
and it turned out to be a great record, by the way. So
yeah, well, that's what I want to ask about, because, you know, these two albums are a little more heavy. I don't want to say darker, but they're almost, you know, heavy metal albums compared to what he did in the past. And then Trash comes out and it's more 80s sort of hair metal kind of thing.
Yep.
Looking back, was management and Alice pleased with Constrictor, or did they think, wow, we misfired?
Because I think, you know, like one of the things, and this is like a good thing for musicians to remember, especially now
right.
with the current sort of
trends,
the current situation of the music industry as it is today. You know, a lot of it has to do with the record company. I mean, there were quote unquote, I believe, songs that could really fare very well on a chunk of radio, whether it's, you know, AHR or, you know, contemporary hit radio, CHR is which everybody, that's kind of the holy grail if you want to get the most exposure and stuff like that. And so a lot of it has to do with the record company. I believe those records were on MCA, which was really one of the first, you know, really stumbling record companies in terms of, like, how the system had just become compromised by, you know, the wrong attitude with the wrong personnel. So I think, you know, there was a lot of great people there as well. That's, you know, it's always that situation, but, you know, the guys that are making all the decisions on what they want to focus on and everything, it's just, it wasn't, you know, it wasn't the optimum situation for either of those records. And, you know, granted, Raise Your Fist and Yell was very heavy, and it was, you know, I'm not sure, like, a lot of people knew even what to do with the record, to be honest with you. So, you know, I think that's, that has a lot to do with it. I mean, the current situation that, that the music industry is in is actually, like, to me, it's where it's supposed to be right now. There's a guy, Garth Richardson, who produced Rage Against the Machine's first, you know, big album. And, you know, he was saying there's a band in Canada that just came out that that charted without a record company. So I think that's going to be the beginning of the lessons that will be learned to sort of, like, completely disassemble the sort of bullshit aspect of the music industry now and start to, you know, you're going to see some new, you know, young guns coming at it from a different angle. I mean, you know, if you're a young band and you want to, like, make some noise, you know, make your own little situation with, you know, YouTube videos and monetize that and direct your video, not for MTV because it doesn't exist anymore. The medium is YouTube. You know, so start. You have to start. You know, we have to start thinking differently. I mean, granted, it's tough because, you know, for me, the some of the biggest moments in history in terms of music, you know, that resonate even today are, like, you know, the era when it was Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin, and, you know, then Van Halen came along. Like, those situations, that sort of huge, energy source for, you know, great music and creativity and the way the industry was working, it's gone. So,
it is.
So you have to sort of look forward now. You don't want to, certainly what's happening now, the status quo that's happening now, is not going to satisfy anybody's need. A lot of people say, you know, the music kind of sucks now. Well, the thing is that music, there's always been a part of music that did kind of suck. There's always been pop, and there's been great pop music and crappy pop music, but there's other stuff always lived alongside of it. Mm-hmm. And right now, it doesn't have it's not getting the exposure, but it eventually will. Because, you know, like, from doing this Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, I ran into some really amazing young musicians that just, you know, could play and do anything. And, you know, sort of, you got to hand the torch off to them. So. So I think a lot of it had to do with the record companies, as opposed to, you know, we didn't sit there and critically say, well, you know, didn't have the right songs or whatever. But, you know, once that decision was made to move off into a different direction, they couldn't have gotten a better guy than Desmond Child. So.
Yeah, to get onto Trash. And by the way, I've done interviews for over 20 years now, and a lot of the rock stars from the 80s have always said MCA was just a bad label to have a hard rock band on. They just didn't know what hard rock was. So
yeah, and even their distribution was less than functional. You know what I mean? Like, that's the other thing, is, like, once you get your head, you know, up the ass of the music industry, you're just sitting there going, like, what has to work? And, you know, in other words, you know, it's not like just the record comes out. There's, like, 50 plates that have to be spinning, and very often there's only, like, three that are kind of, like, not, like, about to tip over. You know what I mean? So,
yeah.
So yeah. But I mean, you know, you move forward. So, you know, whatever.
So moving forward, you finish your career, I guess, with Alice on the Trash album. You did the song Bed of Nails, right? You played on that.
Yep.
Anything else you played on that album, or was it just a one song?
No, it's just they just had me come in and do it. I can't remember what was going on. I was kind of hammered with, you know, getting my own projects, like, you know, sort of reconfiguring myself in terms of, you know, how I was looking at, you know, because, you know, with Alice, we were just constantly doing something. We were touring, we were writing, we were recording. It was like, I was in, like, a couple of movies. You know, it was just this mass, like, you know, flow of work and you know, and just activity. And it was all, like, at the core of it, the nexus of it was Alice. So, so I was, like, trying to, like, you know, sort of reconfigure my priorities and everything at the time. So, I might have been able to play on some more, but, you know, that was it for me. And it was,
yeah.
I love the song, by the way. I was, like, playing on it. It's when I really started to respect and you know, like the way that Desmond operated, because he was sitting there when I'm doing the solo and the things he was saying. I mean, the guy, he's just a really prolific, talented guy.
Yeah, Desmond is great. And we should talk about Desmond in a second, but I just want to quickly get to my next favorite band here. So your solo album, Kane Roberts, comes out in 87, Saint and Sinner's 91. Then we get to 1992, and you start writing with Paul Stanley of Kiss.
Yeah.
How did that come together?
Well, that was, you know, once my first work environments or experiences with my first work experiences with Bob Ezrin were tense, because he's what I would call a kind of a hardcore individual. In other words, he doesn't walk into every situation trusting your instincts, your ability to communicate, your ability to write.
Right.
He walks in there with a basic sense of, you're going to have to prove what you can do with me. So, you know, we weren't getting along, and we were like, you know, there was even some moments, you know, we weren't going to come to blows, but it was like, you know, get out of my way, you know, stuff like that. And then suddenly, you know, there was one day we wrote together, and we just suddenly became great friends, and we started, you know, doing a lot together, and he would hire me for all sorts of different situations. He had me come in and play on a Berlin record.
Right, the one with Take My Breath Away on it.
Yeah, that was definitely...
Did you play on that song?
I don't remember what I played on.
Can you imagine?
I was there for a couple of days. And then...
A Rod Stewart album?
What?
Then there was a Rod Stewart album?
It was a Rod Stewart record where, you know... I in that particular instance, I walked in and, you know, I didn't even think Rod would be there. And, you know, I sat down, I was tuning up my guitar, and the engineer came in and, you know, getting ready to start doing it. And I look and, you know, there's somebody in the vocal booth, and it's Rod Stewart. And, you know, Ezrin, you know, asked me if I was ready. And I they wanted me to play live with him. Which
wow.
was like, and the first thing we did was this blues. And you got to remember, I'm a total fanboy listening to, like, you know, Rod Stewart with Jeff Beck, and it just totally freaked me out when that voice came out of the speakers. I was probably the happiest, one of the happiest moments in my life. So, but he would call me in to do different things. And at one point, he gave me a buzz and he said, you know, I'm here writing with Paul. You want to come up and we'll listen a little bit. So,
yeah. And of you course, know, the now, first thing you say is no, I'm too busy.
No, you know, I know those questions are always funny. And then, you know, I used to be the type of kid that would go into a recording studio when I was like 19, 21, 23, you know, whatever. And I would just bring my guitar there and just say, hey, you know, I play guitar. You know what I mean? And most of the times they were like, you know, who the fuck are you? Get out of here, you know? And there was one time I went into the record plant in New York, and I stepped on the elevator, and there were these guys in there, and I kept looking at them, and it's like wondering. I was like, no way. And then suddenly Gene Simmons said, yeah, it's us. Like that. And I remember like, oh, wow. And then to find myself like sitting with Paul, you know, actually writing with him years later was a huge deal for me. And you know, he was totally like a nice guy. We ended up like, you know, checking out some movies and going out to, you know, get lunch and stuff and hanging. I went to his birthday party at a bowling alley. So, you know, we kind of hit it off a little bit. And then, you know, writing with him is, I came in and I had, you know, a few riffs that I was working on. And, you know, he ended up sort of reversing the pattern on one of them, and that ended up being, you know, Take It Off. And then, you know, we just, you know, I thought we wrote a really great song. And then, you know, I never saw the YouTube video of it, but I just recently saw it, and I couldn't even believe it, the uncensored version. And, I remember I bumped into Gene, and I said to him, dude, I can't believe that video you guys did, the live concert with Take It Off. And he said, everyone told us not to do it because he said, you know, cause they were saying the culture is changing. And he said, we just had to do it. So I don't know if any, you know, people have seen that. It's just, really, it's just insane. Yeah. And then, you know, I went to the studio, and when Bruce was doing the solo on Take It Off and everything, Bruce Kulick, and he totally killed that. So, yeah, that was an all, like, in the plus column as far as an experience.
Were there any other songs that you wrote for Paul that were used either on Revenge or any time after?
No, we wrote, you know, like a few things, but okay. Ostensibly the only thing that came out was Take It Off.
Were you there when Kevin Valentine came in and did the drums on that track?
No.
No.
I was there. I went there one day and hung out with Gene and Paul and Bruce and Bob Ezrin, and then that was it.
So let's talk about those two guys, Bob Ezrin and Desmond Child. Two, I think it's easy to say, musical geniuses. Tell me a little bit about working with Bob and what he means to you, and then let's go to Desmond. Let's start with Bob first, though.
Well, really to get really specific and technical, Ezrin's one of those guys. He's a musician. He's a producer. He's a rough character.
Mm-hmm.
He's a businessman. He's sort of, you know, he's got a lot of things going on. So when you're there, you know, and it's the same thing with Desmond. You better have your eyes wide open. You better be awake, and you better be just ready to just, you know, just grab any sort of, you know, junk he's going to put on the ball when he throws it to you, because it's going to be all over the place, and you got to be able to handle it. And that was one of the reasons why, you know, we got along. I just, for whatever reason, I understood what he was saying. We communicated very well. So working with him was just, you know, it's not necessarily high pressure, but it's one of those things where, you know, you gotta really be on your toes. I remember when I was writing a song with him, and you know, I was trying to find a chord that would get us to a different key.
Right.
And his whole point was, you know, that's a total waste of time. You got to just go where your heart wants you to go musically, and just go there. Don't try to create a little safe little, you know, road to get there. He said, and if it doesn't work, then, you know, you throw the idea away. You know, he's got these opinions, you know, on what he's doing, and you know, the guy can arrange strings. He can do so much. So he's a lot different from a lot of producers. I mean, for example, Michael Wagner isn't a musician on the same sense, but he deals with things, you know, in terms of he can tell when a great performance has taken place, and he's sort of the consummate, you know, sound engineer as well. So, you know, he's got a whole different set of sort of, you know, high level techniques. Desmond, I always say he's one of the most prolific guys I ever worked with. I mean, if we had only 15 or 20 minutes to work, you would walk out there with a completed song in terms of,
wow,
you know, let's say a verse, a bridge, and a chorus. I mean, I've written with a lot of guys where, you know, we're just sort of sitting there struggling with a verse, and then after a couple hours, you know, it's like, all right, let's try this again, you know, in a couple of days. That's not the way he works. If you know, if you're going to be with him during his time, you're going to come up with a structure for a song, and then, you know, you come in again, but you definitely leave with a quote-unquote completed song. And, you know, I remember, you know, I got one of my first sort of, you know, in my world, you know, lucrative publishing deals. And I remember I went to, you know, write with him, and he was on the phone, and I was going to sort of, you know, brag a little bit. But, you know, he got off the phone, and he said, wow, he said, I just got a one-year deal for $3 million. And that was like, you know, mine was for like 5 years, you know, yeah, way less. So I know, obviously, I didn't say anything. So
you just went, all right, never mind, let's just get to work.
Yeah, forget it. What did you want to talk about? Nothing. What do you know? So,
What have you learned from Bob and from Desmond and from Paul and from Alice? What do you take away from those partnerships or relationships or working relationships?
You know, each one sort of represents a different, you know, bit in terms of, like, but you know, you just have to set a really high standard for yourself. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, if you're recording music and you like your song at the end of the recording, you have to ask yourself, would I go out and buy this? You know, like that's your first question that you have to ask yourself. And, you know, you might, like, on your first sort of egocentric knee-jerk response, say, yeah, of course. But you got to sit back and really, you know, put yourself in the position of hearing this for the first time. And, you know, for example, Desmond, you know, he, you know, when you think a song is done, he kept pushing the bar up as much as he could in terms of an arrangement or the slightest detail, you know, in terms of a kick drum or whatever it is. And that's the sort of, you know, value we have to put on whatever sort of creative endeavors that we do. I mean, you know, what was it? Ernest Hemingway, not to quote somebody like that, but Ernest Hemingway said, you know, he was asked, like, why did he become a writer? And he said it was because he could wake up at 4 p.m. every day. And, you know, there is an element of that in terms of being an artist.
Right.
But the truth of it is that, you know, you have to create a the highest possible standard for yourself. Otherwise, you know, you're going to lose next to the guy, you know, who's doing that if you're not, you know. So, yeah, so, and, you know, the other thing is that, you know, I've had some experience with film and working on some films and stuff. And there's a guy that I met, Larry Gross. He wrote 48 Hours and a bunch of scripts, you know, and he was telling me, you know, when we create, whether it's, you know, music or whether it's, you know, movies or painting, that there's a mediocre version of ourselves sitting next to ourselves the whole time that's saying, hey, why don't you just do this? And, you know, it'll be the easy way out. And, he's, you know, the whole job is to get rid of that guy. You know, if you're practicing guitar or singing, you know, you just got to keep the whip out and keep cracking it to make yourself, you know, the absolute best, you know. So
you know, we're approaching an hour here. What are you doing these days? I mean, I know you've done some graphic arts and some video game. Are you still doing the graphic arts and the video game stuff? Are you making a new album? Well, are you joining a band?
Well, no. What I'm doing now is I'm in the process of setting up, you know, a new studio for myself, and I'm going to start recording. You know, the first things I'm going to be doing is just, you know, essentially guitar stuff. And you know, I'm hoping I get to, you know, do some writing with some of my friends this year. I've been, you know, I got to kind of set up to do that. I also, there's a guitar player named Kiko Loureiro, who's from Brazil, that I've been doing some writing with.
Okay.
So, or Loureiro or something. Yeah. So, sorry about that. You could take that out. Sorry. I don't want to piss the kid off. So yeah, I've been doing that, and then, you know, I have this other sort of, you know, business, you know, mind that is at work that, you know, sort of makes, you know, the money that I live on. And, you know, I did meet a partner who he and I are trying to develop also at the same time a business model for, you know, a new type of, you know, record company, and we're going to be putting some bands together and operating off of this. You know, I got these guys that I worked with. You know, with computer and programming and you know, sort of, you know, social media and YouTube and, you know, these guys that just really know all that stuff. So we're trying to create a model where we create a band and then put them into that and never pursue a record deal and really not even pursue the normal outlets of radio, because that system is really kind of polluted at this point.
Right.
And you know, for example, if you want to get on a radio station, you have to donate to something. You have to give money to somebody. And I just think that's just, you know, if you can do things like that, that's one of the great things about something like YouTube is, you know, granted, there's a monetary basis to it, you know, for them on their business side, but you can capitalize it capitalize on it in probably the most altruistic sense of any sort of business model that's out there right now. So that's how we're going to sort of approach this. So that's one of the other things that's interesting that I'm doing. Yeah.
Other than the KaneRoberts.com, is there a site for this where people can go track this down?
Well, eventually, yeah, okay. We'll eventually get it up. But my partner is this guy, Jeff, who lives in Baltimore.
Okay.
And he and I are, you know, taking sort of a slow crawl through it. But we've built up a good sort of basis of, you know, connections and people that are starting to work on it. So, you know, hopefully something will take place with it. Yeah.
Let me just go back to that guy you're working with, Kiko Loureiro. Is he the guitarist for the band Angra?
Yeah, and okay. you could you could, you know, people should check him out. He's a fantastic guitar player. And, you know, we went there and just, I started writing some stuff with him. You know, I met him at Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp. I think it was the one with Gary Hoey and maybe right. Ace Frehley and some guys like nice. That. And we sort of hooked up, you know, creatively, and we've been doing some writing, and hopefully I can get some of those songs recorded.
Oh, yeah. That band Angra is a great band. I mean, a great Brazilian heavy metal band.
Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, just to wrap up here, you know, I'm out in Montreal, and before you were telling me that you were a Boston Bruins fan, and so the question is, how dare you?
I know. You got to understand, that? Though, no matter how violently somebody is, you know, a hockey fan for whatever team,
right.
you definitely stand in front of the altar of greatness no matter what, so, you know, the Habs and the Canucks and all those teams are just huge, you know. And like I was saying to you earlier, you know, when Alice and I would tour Canada, you know, for example, we ended up at the Saddle Dome, and all I could think of was, you know, in the locker rooms was like, whoa, Theron Fleury was here, you know. I just kind of looking around at this sort of sacred, you know, ground that I was standing on.
Hollow
so, yeah,
ground.
Big hockey fan, yeah.
Yeah, well, hey, listen, out in L.A., you got, especially back in the day, you got to live with Luc Robitaille and Wayne Gretzky as your stars du jour, so you turned out pretty good, right?
Oh, yeah, no, I went to see those guys all the time, and it was, you know, and, you know, I think there was one Stanley Cup that, you know, somebody picked on somebody's hockey stick for the amount of the curve, and then that turned the whole Stanley Cup around, and Los Angeles lost. I can't remember what that team was. I don't know. Do you remember?
Wasn't that actually the Habs against
yeah.
the Kings?
Yes, it was, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
I was just kidding you. Yeah, no, it was them. Yeah. So that was a real heartbreak. But, you know,
not on my end.
I know. And, you know, I got to tell you, though, my biggest deal was it's always been the Bruins, but yeah, I'm a sort of a peripheral LA Kings fan.
Well, as you should, because nobody can like the Bruins. That's just bad karma.
Yeah, but I can see how you might say that.
Yeah. Anyway, so there we go. So any last thing you want to plug before we say thank you, good night?
No, just, you know, just check out my my website, you know, and if the, you know, see what's going on. There'll be a lot of updates there, and new music and new photos and stuff, and T-shirts and all that stuff. And then otherwise, you know, go do something else important. So,
So there you go. It's been great. I mean, absolutely fantastic stories, and you know, I truly appreciate your candor and your honesty, and you know, it's been fun.
Okay, thanks a lot, Mitch. That was great.
Thank you. Thank you, Kane.
All right.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye now.